Recently, I remembered my old Vic-20, one of my first computers that I played with when I was a child. So I went down to my dark cellar and took it out of the box where it lived for almost 4 decades. And here it is, yellowed and filthy, but still in good condition. The main thing is that all the keys are still in place and that the lettering is clearly readable. Here in Germany, the Vic-20 was called VC-20 because the German language Vic sounds like a popular expletive. So Commodore called it VC-20. The term VC was marketed as though it was an abbreviation of Volk computer, similar to Volkswagen. Okay, let's open it up and take a look at its guts. The Vic-20 is held together with three screws. With this particular Vic, the screws are missing. This is because the last thing I did with it was taking it apart and see what's inside. Then I lost the screws together with my interest in this computer. So I can flip it open, unplug the keyboard, and yet have plain access to the motherboard. There we find the interface chip that connects the keyboard, joystick, and other peripherals to the data bus. The Vic-20 has two of these. Then we have the video interface chip, abbreviated as Vic. That's what gives the whole thing its name. And there is the character ROM and its heart, the MOS6502 processor. And finally, the kernel ROM that holds a crude operating systems and the basic ROM with the basic interpreter. A big transistor with a heat pipe is used as voltage regulator. This gives us an idea how much power these chips needed for so poor computing capabilities. The smaller chips are logic ICs and static RAM chips, giving the Vic-20 a total of 5K RAM, of which 3.5K could be used by programs. Surprisingly, the screws for the motherboard are still at their places, so I unscrew it and put it aside. If you have any suggestions what I can do with an old useless Vic-20 board, just leave me a comment down below. I also unscrew the keyboard and clean the top and bottom of the case with detergent and a brush. Then I wipe the dust from the keyboard with a damp cloth, and after this, the parts looked almost like new. As a tip, stubborn dirt can be removed with toothpaste or baking powder. Now I'm going to show you how to replace the old guts with a Raspberry Pi and a handful of electronic parts, and thus get an up-to-date computer running Linux. You can use this computer for most of the applications we use on modern computers today. For example, you can watch my videos, subscribe to my channel, and activate notifications in order to be always informed about what I'm doing. Here, everything is soldered together on a piece of perf board. You can reuse the side panel with the original power connector, the on-off switch, and the sub-D connector for the joystick. The components are placed in a way that the board can be put into an empty housing of a Vic-20, like so. The Ethernet and USB ports of the Pi can be accessed from the rear, where the expansion port formerly was. Basically, a Raspberry Pi alone is sufficient. However, if you want to continue using the original power brick, its 9V AC must be converted into the required 5V DC. That's simple. A bridge rectifier, smoothing capacitor, and a step-down converter can do this. But what are the other parts for? The problem is that just switching off a Raspberry can corrupt the files on the SD card and it will never boot up again. So it must safely be shut down before powering it off. Here, this is done by a relay and these two transistors. When powered on, the step-down converter gets powered through diode D1. A millisecond or so later, the converter starts working and powers the relay coil through this transistor. The relay contact closes and the Raspberry Pi boots up. A background service monitors the 3.3V at the Zener diode on GPIO1. When the Matrix keyboard driver module is loaded, the other transistors also get conductive and supplies power to the relay coil. When switched off, this is being detected by the background service that then shuts the Pi down. During shutdown, the relay remains powered through the transistor until the Matrix keyboard driver is unloaded and the sensing voltage of the keyboard column on GPIO27 goes to zero. A capacitor between gate and source keeps the transistor conductive for a few more seconds to make sure that the Raspi has enough time to completely shut down. The transistor then becomes non-conductive again and the current through the relay coil is switched off. The contact opens and the whole thing is powered off. So the upgraded computer can be switched off just as uncomplicated as the original one. Now for the keyboard. Every keyboard is essentially made up of numerous keys with a push button under each key. And these push buttons are joined together as a matrix. That's why we call these matrix keyboards. There is no serial or USB connector like we have on recent keyboards, so we need to find a way to connect the keyboard to the Raspberry Pi. The convenient way to do this is through the Kira module. In this way, we can interface the matrix keyboard and joystick to the Raspberry or any other platform via USB. It costs around 35 euro, but I didn't want to pay that much for it. So I figured out for you how to connect the keyboard directly to the Raspberry Pi by its pin header. But it's not that easy. The solution that works is based on the matrix keyboard driver, which is already included in Raspbian. I modified it a bit so that it also supports the modifier keys like Shift or Control. Then also assigned the keys to their matching characters in the driver's configuration file. The driver can deal with legacy joysticks in a similar way, so we can still use our original Atari or Commodore joystick with the proprietary 9-pin sub-D connector. Please feel free to have a look on my GitHub repository if you want to know more about the details or want to replicate the project. You can find the link in the video description. Finally, we want to connect the Raspberry Pi to a monitor or TV somehow. So we have to find a way to access at least one of the two HDMI connectors from outside the enclosure. A nifty way to do this is with a panel feed-through and an adapter cable. Let's take the HDMI panel feed-through apart and reassemble the parts in an innovative way. Now they happen to fit perfectly into the recess for the former composite video output on the rear. Now connect the micro HDMI end of an adapter cable to the Raspberry Pi and the other end to the feed-through. And here we are. Of course, you can pimp up a C64, an Atari, or any other historic computer in the same way. The Vic-20 and C64 already had a decent keyboard, but it lacks some of the keys that we find on today's keyboards. And others exist on the Vic-20 and C64, but not on the keyboards that we are used to. Still others are in different places. So I also created a keymap file for the X server that makes all of these keys accessible through Commodore keyboards. You can also find this in my GitHub repository. By utilizing this file, the German umlauts are available by holding down the Commodore key while typing in the corresponding letter. If you want, you can easily adapt this file to make the special characters of your language available. After a short familiarization phase, you can type on the keyboard just as fluently as you are used to with conventional keyboards. Now you have an individual computer that can be used for all sorts of fancy things, like programming, office stuff, internet and multimedia. I decided to emulate a C64 and play all the vintage computer games again that I loved to play as a kid. This can easily be done with an emulator for the C64, like VICE. This software emulates any Commodore computer, starting from the PET to the C128. There are no packages available for Raspbian, so you will need to compile it from source. This is straightforward, and you can find the configuration files in the GitHub repository that I linked in the description. Okay, that's all about it for now. Thanks for watching and see you in my next video.